Hi everyone, Lisa Haven here, and this by far is one of the most critical reports that I have done. And I am going to ask you to please share it everywhere, because what's happening in our country today is absolutely critical, because the art of war techniques are being pushed by those on the left, by those on the Democratic left, so much so that I believe with every ounce of my bone that they're attempting to start a civil war. And I, for one, do not want that in my country. I don't want violence to break out. I don't think anybody does. But the truth is, they're constantly painting their opposition in a negative light. And I'm about to reveal the tactics and what they are actually doing to everyone listening. So please forward this to those on the left and the right alike so we can sit on some common ground and stop this once and for all. Here's the thing. The Democrats are claiming that they are the ones under attack, that they are the victims, when in reality, they are the ones who are attacking, and they truly are attacking, and they're using art of war tactics, if you will. In this report, I am going to give you 5 ways in which they are literally plundering and inciting violence against those in opposition to their view. Not even those on the right, but anyone in opposition to their view. They've managed to, over the years, push everyone who opposes them to the far right like they're some lunatic, when that's not the case. It's anyone who does oppose what they believe in. One of the ways, let's start with one. We've got 5 to go through. But the first way in which the liberal left are silencing their opposition and inciting stuff, if you will, is by liberal rhetoric. So what do I mean by liberal rhetoric? Well, it's simply this. It's a liberal attempting to believe what they think a conservative or Republican meant by something, when in reality, you may have not meant that at all. But they interpret it and flip your words around saying, you believe this, so therefore you are this. When in reality, it's not what you meant at all. They're changing your words. Let me give you a couple examples of that. And I'm going to reference my notes because I wrote these down and I want to get them right. Here's an example. If you are against illegal immigration, say you're for legal, doing it legally, but not illegally, right? If you're against illegal immigration, then you are automatically labeled by a liberal leftist as, well, you are a racist against Hispanics. Against immigration done illegally, all of a sudden you become a racist against Hispanics. When in reality, it has nothing to do with the race. Because many people that I know who are against illegal immigration are all for legal, doing it legally, but they're against it because of the repercussions it has on the country. We don't have to look very far to look to Germany to see the hazards that immigration has caused and reaped on the countryside, such as healthcare issues, such as welfare issues, and such as crime issues, bringing crime into the country. It has to do with a political view. It has nothing to do with what liberals have turned it into, which liberals make or equate being against immigration that's done illegally to all of a sudden you are against Hispanics. Do you see how that's done? Let me give you another example, and I want to do a few. If you are pro-life, right? Say you're pro-life and not pro-choice. A lot of Christians, conservatives, Republicans are. Then liberals interpret that as you are against women. You're against feminism. You're not for women. No, one has nothing, absolutely nothing to do with the other. You see, maybe your religious beliefs or whoever you whatever you think, you're just for human life. And you think human life should thrive, whether it's in the womb or out of the womb, right? It has nothing to do with being for or against women. But this is exactly what liberals have turned it into. They've turned it into a racism game. And those on the left, Democrats, included in that as well. Here's another example. If you don't support free healthcare, right, then you're against minorities. They say if you're not for open healthcare for all, then you're limiting minorities from getting that healthcare. When in reality, it has nothing to do with minorities. In fact, their statements kind of do sound racist versus ours. We're simply saying we don't want a healthcare system covered by the government because the government has always failed. We look to the IRS, see how that's done. Look at the DMV offices, see how that's done. Imagine a DMV office like at your healthcare. it doesn't pan out right. So we're against it, not because of some minority racist issue, but because we know what it politically does to the system here in America. Do you see how they twist it? And I know you guys do, but we need to get that far and wide. Here's another example. You're against welfare. Okay, and a lot of people, some people are and some people aren't, but if you are against the welfare system, many are against it because it puts people into cycles. They're never out of that cycle. They're constantly relying on the welfare. That is why. Well, those on the left, those on the Democratic left say, you're against welfare all of a sudden, now you hate black people. No, I think their statement is a lot more racist than anything that's coming from our side, but automatically we've become these bigots based off of a simple political view. And here's one more. If you're a nationalist, simply someone who loves your country, and I say this one a lot, then liberals interpret that as you want everyone else out of your country. You don't want legals, you don't want illegals, you don't want anyone in your country, but basically those who belong to your country. That is not true. That is not true at all. It's not about not letting people or anything into the country of that nature. It's just about, I love my country and I don't want globalism. Either you're a nationalist or you're a globalist. There really is no other option. Here's an example of a report I found of how they've literally painted Republicans as racist. Check this out. This is on theroot.com. How the Republican Party became the party of racism. Do you see how they're painting us in a very negative light? It's like if you're even a Republican, then you're automatically considered a racist when it's not about that at all. They've put our political views into racism. Number two, here's the second way that they are attacking us, and that is through violence, encouraging violence, and encouraging riots and protests. This is happening all across America. We've had Maxine Waters talk about inciting violence against Trump campaign by not inviting them to your restaurants and businesses. Many people from Eric Holder to Madonna and Johnny Depp and Meryl Streep and many others are talking about an anti-Trump agenda and blowing up the White House. All this rhetoric, there's I don't know, 100 some odd of these videos that you can find from political people and actors encouraging violence. And the latest attack actually comes from Ben and Jerry's. Check this out. I'm going to take you straight to Ben and Jerry's website. The ice cream has launched an attack on Trump. This is just their latest one with a new ice cream flavor. They're calling it Pecan Resist, and their disclaimer there reads, alongside all those nutty chunks, this pint packs a powerful message under its lid. Together we can build a more just and equitable tomorrow. We can peacefully resist the Trump administration's regressive and discriminatory policies and build a future that values inclusivity, equality, and justice for people of color, women, and the LGBTQ community, refugees, and immigrants. Pecan Resist supports four organizations that are working on the front lines of the peaceful resistance, building a world that supports their values. Sounds beautiful, doesn't it? All peace and equality. Well, no one on the Republican side is trying not to be equal. No one on the Republican side is doing what, well, Ben and Jerry's is saying that they're doing. And I know you guys are seeing that, but do you see how if you are a Republican today, or if you support Trump, you've automatically become a racist? This is an evil, evil card that they are playing, a very evil card. And it's a very bad one, and it has worked over the years. When you look back in a history's past, it was used before, and they're using it again today. So much so that people don't even want to put Trump signs in their yard or say that they're a Republican. I have to tell you, I went and read articles on the other side, right? And I read some articles that say, talking to liberals, talking to Democrats, that those Republicans and conservatives don't realize they're racist. So we need to help open their eyes about how racist they are. This is the kind of rhetoric that they're parading and pushing on the left, and it's terrifying. This is why I am asking you to make this video viral. Number three, here's the third way in which they are silencing us, and that's through deplatforming. This is their latest attack on us, but deplatforming is happening daily. Let me show you the ones that just happened in the past 3 days. Here's a report here from Breitbart. Facebook blacklist conservative commentator Gavin McGinnis and Proud Boys organization. Here's another from Breitbart. Christian news site, Life site, blacklisted by their web host. Now, they were given 12 hours to get out of there or risk being offline. This is a Christian website who supports pro-life. Here's another, InfoWars. PayPal bans social network gab.com after synagogue attacks revealed them as a user. They were not only taken off of PayPal, but they were also no platformed. So taken off their platform altogether. This is happening almost daily now. And I said it would be one after the other after the other. They go after one, then they pick another, then they pick another, until ultimately we're all gone. That is what they're doing. That is how they're working. And they're even going after our platforms now. Like if we get off Twitter and we form another platform like gab.ai, they attack the platform to take it down. So Twitter is the only option. Do you see the games that they are playing? Here's the next one, number four, political correctness and safe space zones, right? They've literally made it, this is compared to George Orwell's, what is it? Think, speak, or I'm blanking on what it was, but there was a book of words that they could only say. Like you couldn't say fantastic, superb, magnificent. The only word you were allowed to use was good or bad. They simplified the words. Well, this is exactly what political correctness is doing in our culture. It's a sickening, horrible thing that's happening, but it's designed to silence people that the liberals do not like. Let me give you some examples in news articles. The first one here is from psmag.com. Why is milk being called a white supremacist symbol? No joke. Here's another, time.com. Don't call it a brown bag lunch. Seattle frowns on popular term. In other words, milk is racist because it's white. Brown bags are racist because they're brown. Yeah, I wish I could say I was joking, but these are the political levels that they're taking it to, where simple things that you're purchasing are now considered politically correct. Why? Because they can't push the fourth agenda without the first agenda. They kind of go together. The fact, the liberal rhetoric and the fact of political correctness, you have to have that political correctness environment around you in order to make their liberal rhetoric, where they change the words of what we conservatives actually mean, one can't happen without the other. That's why you see them both. And number five, the final one here, is false labeling. And what I mean by that is when somebody is in a political office and they are a minority, then no one is allowed to say anything against their political agenda. If you criticize the political agenda, right, of that minority, then you all of a sudden become a racist, bigot, xenophobe. And that's what they're doing. Let me give you an example. Barack Obama, say you were against his gun agenda, right? I was against a lot of his agenda, for all of it, for the most part, but it wasn't based on the color of his skin. It was based on the political views that I had. For example, he's anti-gun, I'm pro-gun, I'm an NRA member, I believe in the Second Amendment. He despised the Second Amendment. So if I stood out on film against that, then I would be called a racist because I don't like the political viewpoint that Barack Obama had on that. And these are things they're using against us. Here's another example, David Hogg. He was the Parkland shooting kid. Well, you couldn't be against him because he was a young kid. Doesn't matter that he was very anti-gun, and you could be against his anti-gun agenda, right? If you were against David Hogg, then all of a sudden you hate kids and you hate children. That's the kind of rhetoric that is literally destroying us as a country and inciting a country to pure violence. And it makes me sick. It makes me sick that they're pushing this and pushing us to some kind of civil war, and it disturbs me on every level. Please get this message out. And I just want to close with this. It's an Art of War quote, and I think it's very applicable to what we're talking about. But here it is. Appear weak when you are strong. and strong when you are weak. The supreme art of war is to subdue the enemy without fighting. That's what's going on. If you know the enemy and you know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles. If you know yourself, but not the enemy, for every victory gained, you will also suffer a defeat. If you know neither the enemy nor yourself, you will succumb in every battle. That was Sun Tzu in The Art of War. A lot of these tactics are being applied today. And they are subduing opposition without even fighting. They're using the information war. And we're on to it. We know what's going on. We need to start explaining to those on the other side our true beliefs and how one has nothing to do with the other. Because everywhere you go, you turn on the television, you look on the internet, everything is pushing that agenda. They are going full force now into globalism. And we're only here, I don't know how long, a limited time, I don't know how long free speech will be. But my heart goes out to all of you. I believe in the freedom of people to have any political view that they want. Great, as long as you're not hurting someone. Anyhow, I'd love to get your comments below, and I'd love to hear some of the examples that you guys have. And please don't forget to support my channel by checking out my partner, emailwithlisa.com. That's emailwithlisa.com. Now, this is an encrypted email service through Safebolt. And what it does, it is allows you to have an email that can't be tracked or traced, and it is encrypted. And if you delete the emails, it's completely deleted on their end. The emails are gone. They can't be brought back up in the future. This is what we need in today's day and age in order to fight some of the censorship and some of the tracking and watching everything you do. I believe in also the privacy of the American person. This is why I've purposefully partnered with them. I have an email myself, and I encourage you to get one and sign up today, because I can guarantee you the server and the email that you're using is not safe and secure. And they will turn over all that information whenever it calls. Anyhow, you can check that out below and get a discount at LisaHaven_20off. Use that code and you will get a 20% off. And it's all in the description box below. Anyhow, thanks again for tuning in. I'm Lisa Haven, signing out.